I'm Tom Patterson. I have the honor to direct Bolton Guitar Studies. And I want to say a few things before we get right into the subject today. First, I want to say thanks to our guest, David Russell. This is our 13th guest lecture of the semester, and it's the fourth time David has shared his love for the instrument, his knowledge, his time with us. Mind you, they used to be 9 hours, now they're 8 hours in the future. It's nighttime over there. And he's been unbelievably gracious to help us along through this. Well, I don't have to say how trying this time is. An unusual time we're in. So I'd like to welcome and thank David, first of all, for all he's been doing for us.
Thank you.
Also, I'd like to say Anna Maria has been unbelievable getting this thing from sending out the invites, the management of the technical systems and so forth. It's been a huge amount of work, and she should get all the credit for that. So I just want to give my hats off, but if my hat were on, I'd take it off and say thank you to Anna.
Me too.
And Misael also has been working hard behind the scenes, getting our things recorded and up on our web page. I'll ask Anna to put that link here and on Facebook, so you could go to our site later. I think we have four of the first four lectures are up. Many of the lectures we've had this semester will be available to look at a second time or for the first time on video. Finally, I want to say that this will be the last for the semester, but we will start again in January, and I'll announce our first lecture of the spring will be January 15th. That's the spring semester, that is. And Misael Barasatias, who is one of the very few I know who plays classical guitar at an elite level, who also is an elite flamenco guitarist. And he's going to be doing a workshop, flamenco techniques, rasgueados, and so forth, for classical guitarists. So that's going to be on Friday the 15th at 11, and it will be right on through the spring semester with unbelievable events, weekly guests throughout the spring. Without further ado, I want to, again, one last thing. Thank you for Julia Pernet and the Tucson Guitar Society for co-sponsoring these events. All of us are very grateful for all Julia does, and her efforts and collaboration here has really helped this become successful. So thank you, Julia and Misael. And I'd like to
Thank you
hand
very
this over
much.
to David.
Okay, so welcome everybody. So we're going to spend some time together talking about tremolo, and I've prepared a few videos to break it up a little because the tremolo is a very specific technique, and perhaps sometimes we think that all the pieces that are tremolo sound a little bit similar, because we do exactly the same thing. So I thought we'd start off directly with the actual technique, just a little bit, and then we'll develop the whole idea. Now, most people who have played the guitar have probably tried this thing of you just, play a few notes. And it's such a natural movement. If you can get somebody who maybe is normally works in a building site or something, they can just about everybody can do that. So assuming that your fingers are working well, that pattern is just so natural. So it's really just using that the tremolo technique has developed, if you like. Looking into the history, it's a little bit strange because there are some huge gaps in the pieces composed as tremolos. If you look, Sor did none, Giuliani did none, and then in the middle of the 19th century, there was especially Regondi, but maybe one or two more just before that. But Regondi was probably the first composer or guitarist who really used the tremolo to make major pieces, especially one major piece called Reverie. So let's think of all the things that we actually need to make a good tremolo. this is not necessarily in the order of necessity, as all of these things are going to be necessary. One of the things that I find for me to make a good tremolo is to make sure that each fingernail actually sounds the same, or as close as the same as possible, and also feels the same. You know, when you pluck, there's a feeling of resistance to the string. It catches just a little bit, and then you pluck. Now, if one of your fingernails is catching a lot more than the others, then it's going to be a problem. And so the first thing would be to make sure that you can make the same sound and the same resistance, right? And how do you get that? Well, by shaping your nail right and finding just the right hand position for you, which may be different from mine. You know, it depends. People play in many different ways. But that would be the first thing that I would do. And many times when I'm going to start practicing in the morning, I start with tremolo, because usually if my tremolo is working well, all the other arpeggios, not so much scales, but arpeggios and things also work well. And if my tremolo is stumbling or limping, then it's probably going to be the same if I do arpeggios, because it's usually to do with that. So once we've done that, we've got the same sound. You can probably do little things where you go like this, and then MI, just to make sure that the passage from one note to the other is comfortable. Later I'll talk about some of the problems that arise, for example, clicks and hiccups and things. You know, some people, you know, it sort of falls down too soon. But those are really after we've got the basic thing going. So I'll just hold a chord. Now, once we've got that where they're sounding the same, we really have to work at getting a regular rhythm. So you don't have two notes coming fast and then a slow one, like this. That's obviously not going to be very good. Or the typical thing where people have the bass note and then three very fast notes. That's not going to work. So really we need to develop a way where it's as even as possible. In the classical tremolo, which is slightly different when someone does maybe a flamenco tremolo or maybe in certain kind of modern pieces where perhaps the bass note can be very powerful, but in our tremolo, normally we don't want a huge big bass. We want the bass to be balanced with the treble. And in fact, most people usually have too much bass end, too much thumb, and not enough finger sound. So in your practice, just holding your chord, you can play. So you can see it. I'm trying to play gentle bass and medium strong treble. Right? Because it's very easy to do this. Okay? So the big bass is never really going to be a problem. It's getting the treble to be really working well. So we have this thing of the balance between our fingers and our bass. I did one little study which helped me a lot, was to do kind of a kind of ghosting bass sound. So it's like this. You play it first. Sorry, so you can see it. And then just go. No bass. So you kind of play it, but play it so gentle that it almost is not there. This can help you really change the volume and control the amount of bass that you're getting. Some people use a lot of apoyando, bass, rest stroke in the bass, like this, where it falls onto the next string. And especially in flamenco tremolo, flamenco players use that a lot, but there are many classical players that use that. I think it's worth learning to do that and then not do it very much. Only do it in very, very few specific moments where you want a really big, deep bass. Because the kind of... I might ka-chun. This kind of... Sorry. Can make a very deep bass without it being piercing, because sometimes if you play it loud like this, it's too piercing. So the apoyando bass is also helpful. Just to break it up, Anna, can you put on one of the tremolos now? Put on the one that says Regondi Reverie.
Absurdly good. My God. Wow. So I'm inviting everyone at the, I did forget something, which is common these days, me forgetting things with being locked home. We will have a Q&A question and answer session at the end. We'll go for about an hour and then David will be, he'll tell us all the any questions you have. So if you write them in chat or write in chat in Facebook, which I'm not watching, we'll make sure they're given to David so he can respond.
Great. Okay. So I also wanted to just say hello to a couple of people that said that my mum should be watching. So, hi, mum. she's seen all of them and enjoys it very much. Also, I have a friend here in Vigo. And Alex, te saludo. Si estás ahí, va a ser lo único que voy a decir en español para que aprendas un poco más de inglés. He said, trouble is he can't understand it all because it's all in English. So I said, you've got to learn some more English. But I promised him I would say hello. Okay, now let's go on a little more with some of the technique things, right? Now, there is a thing between long fingernails and short fingernails. Now, some people with really long nails play a great tremolo and it's not clicky and things. I don't know how they do it. If my nails get too long, I need to play, I can only play a bright tremolo. I can't make the soft, gentle type of tremolo. So I can really only talk about the way it works for me. But I remember many years ago, I was in a class with John Williams and he wasn't playing a concert that time. So his nails were really long and his tremolo was fantastic and it didn't click at all. But the way I work at not having the click, just so you'd really know what I mean about this. Some people, when they're playing, and you hear this, kind of, like you can hear the nail clattering against the string, right? I don't know if you can hear that. That's really horrible sound. Well, when that happens, it's kind of ugly. And you know, sometimes you hear players, and then if they either get tense or something, and it gets really clicky. The way I do it so that it doesn't click is that there's a point where the flesh and the nail kind of meet, and that is my preparation spot. right? Now, if my preparation spot goes right there, then it's not going to click because there's a little bit of flesh touching just at that moment, right? Maybe other people do it differently because some people feel that they don't actually touch the flesh. I don't know. But what I would suggest is that for those that maybe don't click very often, but sometimes suddenly they start clicking, the problem is to know what you're doing when you are clicking. So you should learn how to click on purpose, how to be clattery on purpose, and then you know what's happening and then get rid of it. Now, when I click a lot, if I make my fingers a little bit too stiff and I make them move kind of slow, like that, I click a lot. So if my fingers are looser, doesn't click. So that's one thing that I think is important for people to discover how to get rid of it, right? I can't give a direct solution because each person has slightly different movements. I think if you're having a really clicky day, just go straighter. And if you play straighter, it's less clicky than... So when you're going for the dark sound, this sort of like more velvety sound, you're in greater risk of clicking, okay? So if you're having a clicky day, just go straighter. Okay, the next thing I think we should talk about is the importance of the A finger in the tremolo. Now, the reason why I think we should give it some extra importance is because the A finger is the first note that they hear. So when you have... the tremolo, the tune is starting always there. And there's a few places where you may get... Now you have a new note that comes in. You want the listener's ear to go to that new note and not to go to the bass note. Here's going to the bass note. So, no, you need that top note to come as soon as possible and to be as attractive as possible. Also, the reason why I think it's good to work on what's happening here is because there's a natural tendency. These two fingers are kind of more joined than, say, these two or these two. These two have a lot of independence. These two don't have so much independence. So when the A finger plucks, it pulls the M down. The M wants to follow the A. You know, when we pull the A in, the M follows it. So many times what happens to many people when they're having problems is that the M finger flops onto the string almost immediately. And it's there too soon. So I think of the A finger note being as long as possible. Okay? So make up some exercises that lengthen the A finger note. And one that I like, and you can use it actually for all fingers, but for this one, is we would start tapping your foot, but you actually have to tap your foot. Don't just feel off the beat. No, really tap your foot. First of all, on the thumb, which is very easy, right? So we just take our thing and we go. Just like, so you can see the fingers. Okay. And you can go. Okay, that was pretty easy, right? Now we move the tap to the A finger. And then you move it to the M finger. And then to the I finger, which is easy. Right? Now, by actually moving the beat, not just giving an off beat, you move the beat, it makes you think with this finger, not think with this finger. Okay? Most of us kind of, it's natural. This is the dominant finger, so it's very easy for us to think that this is the one. Now, if you try to move it to this, it'll help you give more importance to the A finger note. Okay, let's try another video, just to think. Seeing as we did Rigondi, how about having Anna, can you put on the other one, the one that's called the air? Now this one, just before you put it on, I'll mute myself in a moment. It's interesting because Rigondi, first of all, there's a part that is, it's a variation, it's a set of variations. And there's one variation that's a tremolo variation. Then there's another variation that at the end, he mixes tremolo with scales and arpeggios and things to make real virtuoso music. You know, obviously, Ragondi must have been an amazing guitarist because his music is much more demanding than most things that Giuliani wrote. Or, I'm say Giuliani, because who must have also been a wonderful guitarist. But, you know, that whole generation later, I think Ragondi was a real whiz kid. And although he didn't write a huge amount of works, those that he did are really great. And the way he uses the tremolo, especially towards the end, I've left the other variation in between. I didn't want to cut it. So, can you put it on, Hannah? There was another thing that came out in that piece, which is really interesting, because when you play some tremolos, it's just the tremolo itself. But then you find in all the good tremolo pieces, there's always something extra, right? And at the end of that piece, I think I've got it here just so I can... he's got these bits where he's got... So you have to actually come down... It's possible that he played it like this. But there are some places that it's just a single note. So you'd have... And you need to jump down with the index. Tárrega also uses that in... Not in the Recuerdos, the famous one, but he wrote another piece called Sueño. And in the Sueño, he has a tune in the middle voice, right? So Ragondi uses it both in the Reverie and in this one, which complicates quite a lot, your normal tremolo. Okay, now I wanted to go on to something else to do with the tremolo itself. Now, I've heard some people play with maybe not very good tremolo, but they played with a lot of expression and a lot of energy, and it sounds fantastic. And then I've heard other people play with a wonderful tremolo, technically just extraordinary. And if they play the piece boring, it sounds boring, right? So the pure mechanism, it's important, of course, but, you know, what you do with it is actually much more important. And so in that one that I just played, there's quite a lot of flexibility in the tempo, and you'll notice in some of the other ones that I'll put on later, that some tremolos are fast, some are slow, some need to be able to get loud, get soft, etc. So all the things that we do to shape our music are really important, and we can put that into our practice as well. So really, you know, you think with a tremolo, what can you do? You can get louder and softer, faster and slower. And there's one other variation, right? Which would be darker and brighter. So we might as well study all of those. Sorry, just so you can see it. So just getting fast and slow. All speed, full speed. Slowing down. And so on, okay? So put that into your study. Make studies that have that. Because in your piece of music, there's going to be moments when you want to slow down. Like, so you want to be able to slow down to shape that the top of that phrase. You know, there are other moments that maybe you want to speed up because you want to give the piece some energy. Very important. The second one we talked about was getting loud and soft, right? It's not so easy because in tremolo, usually when you start to try to get loud, the thumb gets loud, but the tremolo itself doesn't change that much. But well, it's a start if the thumb gets loud, but it would be important to make some studies where we have super quiet. A little louder. And so on. You know, I'm doing it all on the first string. You should practice many of these things on the second string as well, because the tremolo is a little different there, which I'll talk about in a moment. Right? But the first string is easy to do, but the first open E string is sometimes not the most beautiful note, so maybe take another note, play a D chord or something. Okay, so we've got getting fast and slow, getting loud and getting soft. Now the other one to complement that would be to get dark and get bright, right? So if we are doing, well, the I'm gonna get very bright. Or for example, if there's a place that you want to get kind of angry with the music, like here, I'm going to get really quite bright. This one coming now. And then very sweet. So I want to be able to change my sound as the notes change. You know, while you do this chord, that chord I want to be super warm with. Now, how would you do that? Well, there's several things. One is this. I mean, you could do it moving up and down, but sometimes when you move down here, the notes start to become kind of detached and things. So stay more or less there and just move around like that, okay? There's a chat thing there, so. And then you can hear the difference, I think, right? You will notice also that if you raise your wrist, it'll also get brighter. So you can mix the two. Don't be too radical. I'm going kind of really exaggerating, but just something that kind of either warms up a note or brightens up a note. I think it's important to help the music, right? So let's break with for another piece now. This is a fun one. I was telling Anna earlier, just while we were preparing, because we're kind of in confinement, I have a lot of free time. So I've been digitizing some of my old videos. So the first one you saw was me playing, it must have been about 1980, more or less, because that's when I had that guitar, which I still have. It's not here in the room, but I still have that old Gilbert, and it's fantastic, beautiful instrument, really. So I know more or less the date. This one, we're going to put on the sueño, Anna. It's a fun thing, because here, I kind of played around, you'll see quite a few different guitars in it. Okay? Can you put on the sueño? By Barrios.
His favorite piece is, it's called Sueño en la Floresta.
Thanks, Anna. Yeah, I did the whole piece sort of like just in little bits, and used about 10 different concerts, and it's kind of weird because some things I do exactly the same now. Just they haven't changed in so many years, but you would think, well, maybe I'd learn some more with time, but it's not the case. Anyway, in that piece you could hear quite a lot that the flexibility in the tempo, you know. Now, one of the things that is also important that you'll find that some pieces require very fast tremolo, and other pieces actually require much slower tremolo. So it shouldn't be just kind of one technique. You should be able to really adapt to the piece itself, you know. And I'm using my own videos rather than have to play it here, because it's kind of fun. It was fun for me doing all the things, and I thought I'd share all these little bits with you. So we've more or less covered a lot of the technique, although after in the questions, maybe we can talk some more. There's one other one which I'll talk a little bit about, but Misael will do much more for you, perhaps, is the flamenco tremolo, where they add a note in. And I use it in a couple of places. There's a place in the Una Limosnita, which is another piece by Barrios, that you go up to the high top part, and you can either just slow the tremolo down. It goes like this. Now, what I did there was I just slowed down at the top, and the tremolo slows down itself as well. The problem with slowing down the tremolo is that you give away the secret. You know, suddenly the people can hear 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. They can hear the notes. So the tremolo that the flamenco people use most of the time is so there's one more note. You add an index. Right? It's a really neat trick. And so you can actually play a tremolo a lot slower and it still is full. And if you hear many of the flamenco tremolo pieces, you know, the tarantos and things like that, that the beat itself is slower than ours, and yet their tremolo is very full, you know. So here you could go like this. And actually move into the five-string, five-note tremolo. As far as, I mean, that's one place I've used it, but a composer wrote a piece for me, which I'll put on for you later, that we really, well, he really used it a lot, and because really I felt that the piece needed to be slow, and he suggested slow, but the normal tremolo wasn't working. So I made the suggestion of the five thing. It sounds great, and it moves between five string and four string, and five note and four note tremolo, right? But seeing as I was talking about some of the history and things, you know, we should really go into watching the time. So the most famous of all tremolo pieces is by far Tárrega's piece, right? And the Recuerdos de la Alhambra. Now, this piece, for those of you who don't know it, it's the one that goes like, and so on. It's a wonderful piece. And in some ways it's Tárrega's his masterpiece, although I think he wrote maybe the Capriccio is also really up there. But it's nice to know about the place that inspired the composer. And the Alhambra, as you say in English, the Alhambra is this amazingly wonderful palace in the south of Spain, in Granada. And the piece actually had another title. He called it, you know, it's A Granada, to Granada, and other titles right before it was published. It was published some years later after he wrote it. He wrote it around about 1889, I think. I can't remember the actual date. I'm not good as a historian. But, and he visited Granada, you know. So I went there. I played a concert in the Alhambra once, and it was a fantastic place to play. It's just pure magic, and of course I played the piece. But some years ago I went for a TV program, and so I'd like to put on this rather odd video, which is a video, it's like the making of the video, okay? It's just a little bit. So Anna, can you put on the Recuerdos? Thank you. I almost jumped out in the skin when the producer says cut at the end there. Anyway, that piece has it's a wonderful tune and really sits so well on the guitar, and it really makes the guitar sing well. You know, Tárrega, one of his virtues, he really understood which parts of the instrument were going to work well and didn't put us in great trouble. But he did ask for one little thing in that piece, which is really quite difficult to do. There's a little ornament, and it goes. So just there. And to get that to happen right, if you do exactly what Tárrega asked for, let's find the other one. So he's asked for this. Sorry, just so you can see my fingers. So just where the ornament comes, you actually only have to play with these two notes, and this one you miss out. So, and you have to have a good coordination. Right? It's really quite hard to do, and it's by far the most difficult thing to fit into that piece, right? But it's really a little magical turn there on the tune, and it happens right through the tune in different places. Right, so that little bit really needs a whole extra lot of practice and a whole another level of ability, if you like. The rest works fine. I think if you're really struggling with just what Tárrega wrote, with the slur, you can actually make it work just by keeping the tremolo going, and you miss out one note, so you have. Right. So now, when you do it slowly, it doesn't sound very good, but I'll do one of them fast. That was a bad one. It's because I've been practicing the other one. But it works. But the coordination really is, it's kind of vital to get it good, perfect, right? I think the Recuerdos de Alhambra is a tremolo that really doesn't need to be very fast, you know. Will work very well, because Tárrega has asked for an accent here. Accent. Accent. So I think the piece works better as a slower tremolo. As far as fast tremolo go, I'd like to cite this and listen to Rodrigo's great masterpiece for the solo guitar. For me, it's his best piece for the solo guitar, The Invocation and Dance. Now, The Invocation and Dance, it has this dance, so you pop, and you can't really do that any slower, or. If you go any slower with the dance, it just like it sounds like a clog dance instead of a Spanish bright, vital and full of energy dance. But then what happens when the tremolo comes, and I've heard quite a few people do this, and I don't think it sounds good, is when the tremolo comes, it just slows down. It's just like the whole energy of the piece goes flops for me. So I like it to be at least at the same speed on the tremolo. So, Anna, can we do the... This is also me a long time ago, playing the Invocation and Dance. Thank you. Thanks. Okay, that's a fantastic piece. It's a really hard piece to play, but it's so satisfying when it goes well. And I learned that a long time ago. You know, since then the piece has gone through a whole kind of metamorphosis, really. And the first version that was published had the name Graciano Tarragó as fingered by, and then it was Alirio Diaz, and he kind of arranged it and took out some bits, changed some things. And then then there was another version, and now it's published by the family. And they've actually, it's very much like the very first one that came out, right? With some bits that are, I'd say, almost impossible to play. It's a little bit of a piece that I think a little bit of arranging doesn't hurt it. In the piece there, I play a few notes that I would change now. But I think, you know, two different notes doesn't change the interpretation. It's just, you know, from musicological point of view, it's interesting, you know. Okay, moving forward, because I want to leave time for some questions and things. Now, it's interesting that composers, that I think Rodrigo really found a new thing, a new way of using the tremolo, because a lot of the tremolo pieces that have been written by many people were not very successful, in part because if it's not a tune, it's not, why play a tremolo, you know? And in some ways tunes went out of fashion, and although some of the composers, like, you know, Ponce, Tedesco, and others, they all did some little bits of tremolo, still didn't get anywhere close to what Tarraga did. And I think Rodrigo was maybe a huge jump when he wrote that piece. But there's another composer that wrote two tremolos that I like very much. He maybe did some more, but maybe we'll only put one video on. Federico Moreno Torroba wrote, you usually call him Torroba, but it's Torroba, okay? And Torroba wrote The Castles of Spain. It's a really very nice group of quite short pieces, and each one is about one of the famous castles in Spain, or not so famous, some of them. There are 13 of them, and there are two that are tremolo pieces. One is called Simancas, which is, well, it's not such a beautiful castle, but the other one I like a lot is called Zafra. And Zafra is a stunning, really more like a fortress, really, than a castle. And it's used in the Game of Thrones, right? So if you've seen, I think it's season 6, this castle is used, right? So, Anna, can you put on Zafra? Now here, I just want to say, before you put it on, I like it because in some ways Torroba has kind of taken a different... He hasn't tried to make simply a nice tune or an interesting tune. He's really gone to town, and it's a short piece, but he's mixed it in with some arpeggios, scales and things, and I think it really... It's quite a dramatic piece. Okay, Anna, please. Okay, so I think it's a really neat piece. It's completely unknown, really. And Maria and I had this idea, which at one point when I was playing those pieces, if we had like a few weeks to go to each castle and film myself playing the piece with the castle. You know, some of them you can't actually get into without permission. That one is owned privately, for example. But I think you can get permission to go to it, but still, it would be an interesting thing. So, just to continue with this thing of the development of the tremolo and things, and, you know, all of these things, as you can see there are some places where, boom, there's a chord during the tremolo, right? And it's quite difficult to do. I can't remember the note, but, you know, it's maybe... mixing in... that. Those ones there, I did with the flesh. So it's one of the things I'd written down here to remember, you know, different things with the thumb. When you're doing a tremolo, you can play... Here we go. You know, the more variety you have, the better, right? So if you can also have variety in what you do with the thumb, so you could have sharp thumb sound or fleshy sound, right? Depending on what you want to do. And I always remember that bit in the recuerdos, that's that moment that goes, that high note. And I was enchanted by it in the old recordings of Segovia that I had when I was a child, you know, and he made such a beautiful note on that, and I'm convinced he played it with the flesh, because it sounds like... Also, Segovia's wonderful vibrato on it, but... So that one there, I have to make sure that I don't get the nail on it. Sometimes the nail on the second string, not so good. So... You know, so learn to be flexible with your thumb. Now, just to talk about the development of the tremolo, and how some composers have found like a new way of using it. I want to put on this piece by a composer, my friend, called Ben Verdery, and he wrote this piece some years ago for me, and it's dedicated to me and to Maria, my wife. And Ben wrote it, it's called Now and Ever, and it's actually his musical expression against slavery. So his original idea was not now, not ever. But Ben is a very positive and enthusiastically sees the good side of life. So he changed it, or before it actually, it's now and ever, but meaning not now, not ever. Like, and so this is an extract. It's really the end. And it's a two-movement piece. The first movement is really beautiful with a very unusual tuning and a capo on a funny high place, but only covering half the strings. And he achieves some colours in the guitar that are wonderful. This here is this end of the second movement, where it goes from a chaos into a kind of mystic, gentle, long tremolo. And this is the one that there are lots of parts that I use five note tremolo moving into four note, five note, four note. So at here, I'm playing it, but I've put up the score. So Anna, could you put on Now and Ever? Thank you. There we go. So I think Ben found, that's Ben Verdery's piece, Now and Ever. And I think Ben really found, shall we say, a new way of using the tremolo. So it, you know, a lot of the other tremolos are a little bit, I won't say bad or anything, but sometimes they don't sort of rise to the next level, if you like. And I think he achieved something special there. We've talked a lot about different things. Maybe now we can open it up for questions. And I don't know if I can see the questions, or Tom or Anna, will you answer them for me?
Ask them. I won't answer them, but I will ask okay. them for you.
Go ahead.
First of all, those who are not in America, next Thursday we have something we call Thanksgiving. And my God, David, this was just fabulous. Thank you so much. Thanksgiving to David for sharing his time and his knowledge with us. And those early videos from 1980, in fact, that invocation dance I heard David play in Bellingham, Washington, way back in the day, and he actually took care of my students while I came down and auditioned for the job here in Arizona. I put him in charge of my... Now he's doing the same thing again, taking care of all of us. Thank you, David. So John asks, he's learning recuerdos, and he's noticed that relaxing is very important. Seems to get tense when he warms up. So do you have any advice how to play tremolo even more relaxed? Should I think of attack to the strings hard or soft? Thank you. That's from John.
Yeah, I think it's a tremolo technique, or it's like an arpeggio technique, that it's continuous. It's very easy to get tense. The tension just kind of builds up, right? So, obviously, you know, if you're using just the right amount of power, then there's less likelihood of getting tense. But first of all, I would say, depends on how old someone is, but I think the older we get, the more carefully we should warm up, right? So I use tremolo to warm up. I don't do a fast, loud tremolo if I'm warming up. I do much more gently and let the volume just stay there. No faster than that. Really, you know, look more for accuracy and for smoothness rather than power. Power doesn't really come from muscle power. It actually comes from the speed in the finger. That's what will make the note pop out and have more volume, if you like. You may have to think about, if you're getting tense, is your breathing okay? You know, many people's breathing is altered when they play. You know, they start to breathe in a very small amount, so they're not breathing. You don't want to hyperventilate, but you want to make sure that you take fairly deep breaths. Also make sure that when you're actually sitting, your shoulders are not hunched. You know, many people get tense up here. You know, if we're talking about the right hand, it starts here and then it radiates down the whole arm. So really, if you're not comfortable here, it's going to be difficult to play well, you know. And you may find that also some people, as they get tense, they, just so you can see again, they squeeze down. Okay, you know, make sure that you're not squeezing down more than necessary. You know, a little bit of the body weight or the weight of the arm can lie on there, but don't squeeze it down. You know, many people, especially on difficult chords, there, pulling in and at the same time squeezing down, that's a lot of energy just wasted, you know. I don't mean that we should play with energy, but make sure that that energy isn't useless tension. Okay, so I would think about making sure that this is relaxed, and hopefully this will become relaxed. But, you know, to play well, you can't be completely relaxed. If you just relax, your hand's going to fall down. You know, so you do need some body tension to play well. So I like to think of myself more when I'm playing, more like the person who is kind of ready, like a judo guy, you know. I don't do judo, but, you know, it's not... This transmits zero, you know. Some energy is necessary, but make sure that it's energy that is, or tension that is not going to hurt your movement. Hopefully, you know, it's difficult because sometimes when you see somebody close up, you can say, this is wrong. This is, you know, you're squeezing it here or you're doing it there. So it's difficult as a general rule, but in general, make your breathing good, make your sitting position good. You know, if your spine is more or less straight, not curved at the bottom. You know, many people, if you curve there, the whole, everything scrunches up in the body. So if that, like, you know, stick your stomach out a little bit and flatten your stomach, you know, and sit at the right height. I'm on a sofa, but I've got several cushions here to be just at the right height so I can sit properly. The more you're balanced in your seat, the less you're going to be tense. Oh.
Super. Here's a practical one. How does the wedding ring affect you playing guitar and playing your tremolo? It's on your A finger.
Yeah, I've got a lot of, you know, it's not that I got married four times. I got four of them. It's just that, no. After 10 years, or maybe it was less than, yeah, maybe 10, that's right, 10 years, you know, Maria and I didn't really know what to give each other. We'd had such nice 10 years that they said, another wedding ring, come on. And, you know, and so then when we did 25, we got another one and so on, you know. So we've been married for 35 years. So I've got these four of them. They're skinny little ones, you know. It makes zero difference for me. I just will say some things, you know, that when you relax your hand, my A finger sits a little bit low because when I was a child, when I was a young guy, I broke this bone and it sits a little bit lower than it should. But it seems to do zero difference to my tremolo.
I broke mine the same way on Jimmy Durden's head.
Oh, yeah. Mine was my brother.
There you go.
Amazing.
Okay, I remember the kid. It was like when I was 11 years old. I remember his name. That's crazy. What are your thoughts about, there's a number of questions here, David, about alternate forms of playing tremolo, P-I-A-M, P-M-I, P-I, whatever, P-M-I-A, you know, there's various P-M-I-M, P-I-M-I, et cetera, as not only for practice. I know in the old days you recommended all these variants for developing the tremolo, but actually performing the tremolo.
You know, I think people who maybe sometimes have finger problems, you know, their pattern gets messed up, you know, without it necessarily being focal dystonia, but maybe just the pattern just goes crazy and things. And I have several friends who do tremolo slightly differently. One because of this reason. So he just turned it round and you can do perfectly good tremolo the other way around. Just so you can see it. You know, it's okay. It's a little bit unnatural because if you actually tried tapping your fingers I first, and yeah, you can do it, but you're fighting a little bit with it. But you know, we have to do arpeggios. So it's basically that, but just on one string, right? So I would say, even for warming up, sometimes do a tremolo just with two fingers. Starting with I, and then starting with M. And then AM. Gets a little bit more difficult. Starting with M. This one's easier. Right? So, you know, you could aim at that. I like to do that sometimes to really work at the independence between these two fingers. And Anna Vidovich plays with two fingers, you know, and she's really fast, and so she can do the tremolo like that. And she can do the normal one as well. But it comes out better for her, the other one. So I think for most people, the traditional way is going to work best. And I would only really aim at using a different pattern if the traditional one was messed up for me, you know. Okay, there's Misa. I say, and no, the pinky finger, that's a separate technique, you know. And some people do it. And in fact, there's a guy who had a whole publication to do with the little finger. Can you imagine? You know, a guitar publication with the only thing about the only finger we don't use. But I didn't file mine today. I didn't. But you know, some days I just make sure that it doesn't sound too horrible. But you know, a five-string chord is kind of neat. You know, to be able to go and play a five-string chord together, right? You know. I don't want to roll that. It's Bach. That's using there. So if you can use it for a chord, why not? It's really difficult, but it might be. Maybe you need a very long fourth finger so it can reach. But it might be a technique that's worth doing.
Pedro asked about altering the hand position. I believe you probably have talked about that, about tipping the hand during the piece and so forth. So yes. I think that one you addressed for us.
The three movements really would be up and down the string, right? Angle, and then up and down with the wrist, right? Those three, you will change the sound in different ways. Yeah, we talked about it earlier.
And Pedro is sending greetings from Beirut.
Oh, wow. Hi, Pedro.
Yeah. Welcome, Pedro. Damien,
so if you missed it, Pedro, you can go and see it in Facebook from the beginning. And there's a point where I was talking about the changes of sound.
Damien, who says greetings from Argentina, would, if you could give a brief kind of list of works you find maybe progressively from more simple to more complex. Maybe give us five. Easier to more complex.
You know, strangely enough, all the tremolos that I know that are really good, each of them have some difficulties, some quite notable difficulties in them, or they are part of a really difficult, a more difficult piece. There are many, many studies and many books. Before I did this, I'm looking through, really I wanted to find out when the earliest tremolos are. And there's an interesting one from José Viñas, and it's very simple. Viñas was actually around about the same time as Regondi and before Tárrega. And he has a tremolo which is called Recuerdos de Palma. Palma is a bit, and it's really strange because Tárrega ripped it off. Let's see if I got Viñas. Here we go. Because the beginning is like this. Right? It's the Gran Jota. And even the end of that bit still goes after a scale. And then here's... And then a fairly easy tremolo. Very simple kind of tune, right? But Tárrega used his intro for his big piece. That's one. I don't have a list of pieces that are, if you like, progressive, because as one knows, you know, I don't teach anywhere. I don't really have a kind of a planned out way of how you would do it. And I'm sure there'll be many teachers who would have already planned that. But just talking about teaching methods and whatever, I went over some of the famous methods, and there is very little in the 19th century, very little about tremolo. In Aguado, zero. In Carulli, zero. There's one piece by Carcassi that it's a Carcassi study that we all learned that goes something like this. Something like that, you know, and that here they call it, what's the tremolo study, you know, because it starts, it starts with a tremolo or like a tremolo. But there's one piece by Paganini that he does a kind of tremolo, but it's actually, he does it sort of triplet, and it goes, You know, it's written like that. So in the 19th century, until Regondi came along, and then Tárrega, and then, although Tárrega didn't really write a method as such, those that came after, like Pujol and, other teachers, great players, then there's some more things about tremolo. But it's really in the 20th century and now that you will find a lot more written with easy, good tremolos. I don't know which ones to tell you about.
Our next question, and incidentally, if you would bear with us, we're going to go past 90 minutes. I hope that's okay, because
that's fine. No
there's problem. There is a number of very excellent questions. The next one comes from Hobe. What are your thoughts on planting? And I assume he means preparing the A finger while working on the tremolo.
Yeah. Perhaps in the development, it's not a bad idea to maybe prepare with the A finger. But one of the things that we didn't talk about, but you know, a bouncy hand is murder. It's not going to work. If you have a bouncy hand, you know, some people, when they play, they do this, right? That's not going to happen. Your tremolo is not going to happen if you do that. You need to be able to play through without any movement, right? Now, the problem is, if when you play the bass note, you plant the A finger, your tremolo is going to be cut, the actual tone. So if you kill the basses, it's stopped. So that note ringing on is really quite important. And then we put the basses in. So I try to leave it there as long as possible. You know, tremolo is most successful when all the notes join together and you don't hear the impact so much, right? You know, that's why it's nice to play a tremolo when you're in an echoey place, because your melody just becomes one long song, you know? Whereas when you play it in a dry place, it goes taka-taka-taka-taka-taka. Sounds like kind of that machine gun thing, you know? Maybe for some pieces, it might be okay to do that. But generally, not so good.
Okay. Next, I just want to say, Ashwin, if you look in the chat, shared a YouTube video of David teaching tremolo. So later you guys can take a look at that and get even more of his insight. Lee Thompson from Santa Fe, New Mexico, has heard an 11-note tremolo from Manolo Sanlúcar. Do you know of the other pieces that use that technique?
Well, I mean, an 11-note, he must have used mixed the thumb into the top. I think.
David. It's Misael, by the way. I know which one they're talking about. It's a piece called Prayer Oración, and I think he just kind of goes back and forth with the I am in A, just kind of back and forth, creating like a long sort of prayer like melody. It's quite a beautiful piece, actually. Yeah. Since I know the piece, I figured.
Sort of like this.
Yes. Exactly.
Good. Yeah, I think if it's controlled well, it can be really nice. You know, I was in Ben Verderi's piece, I was kind of thinking of using some of that, but in the end, it didn't really become necessary. But there is, it's interesting, you know, that Villa-Lobos, he achieves a kind of tremolo.
Yeah.
In the is it study number 11? I think it is.
11.
So it's a kind of tremolo thing, but it's, physically it's an arpeggio. You know?
Yeah.
It's interesting. And then the other person that did many tremolos, in some of them are pretty wild, is Stepan Rack.
You
know, Stepan's, some of his pieces, he got big tremolo pieces. But he, I remember I was in a party with him once, and so he's playing his tremolo, he's going at full speed. He also uses the little finger at times and things. And then says, I do tremolo in two strings, and then three strings. So it's just like huge amount of sound coming out of the guitar. I couldn't do it, but he was instead of using rasgueado, he was using the tremolo technique, going over several strings, and he controlled it. So,
so there, Julia, I'm sure sorry to interrupt. Julia is asking about the five-note tremolo and asking, do you play with a pinky or what formula do you use?
No, I use like most of the flamenco guys, you put an index first. So it's like this. Right? So, I mean, we should really get Misael to play this, but there's some of these pieces that are, you know, fantastic pieces to play, but let's see. This is one that you can get. It's, I really need a capo on this. Well, still. That piece, and then it goes. You know, so I have to practice it up a bit, but it's really. Sorry, so you can see it. So I'll do it slowly. Right? That's what the way that most flamenco players do. Is that right, Misael? Can you answer that?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I love hearing you play flamenco, by the way. So I'd rather have you play it. Yeah.
Come on. I prefer to hear you play it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's
I like right. to read through sometimes, you know, it's kind of fun, you know, but I don't have a flamenco, proper flamenco guitar here, and sometimes it's difficult to do some of the little twiddly bits.
Yeah, yeah.
Jose is asking about when you play David Asturias and arpeggios of Giuliani, you play with M&A, where a lot of people would play I&M, and he's asking, does this help the independence of your tremolo, making these two fingers stronger, independent from the index?
Yeah, it could be. You know, it's just that when you're going, let's see, it's, so it would be. Just these. You know, so rather. But, you know, there are two reasons why I do that. I mean, the main reason is because it sounds better. The other one is just as easy for me. But for me, the quality of sound on my middle finger is not quite as good as on the A finger. And I have to really work to not go right on the east, on the top string with M. It can be just a little bit bright, so I just used this one. But what happened was, actually it was partly because I had this broken finger that I thought, wow, my A finger's not very good. So I practiced lots of things that use the A finger, and that was one of them, and it works well. But I wouldn't advise someone else to do that. It just works for me, you know. And usually if I'm doing just like thirds, you know, just something like that, I'll just... If it's going fast, I need to pass to these two, because if I need to go, I'm not so good at, not so good. I can do it, but it's not comfortable. Whereas with IM, I'm much more comfortable. But if it's a little bit slower, I'm using those two. But I wouldn't advise someone else to do that. It's just because it works well for me.
Now we have... I'm not sure how to say this name. Anarka. Do you use the left hand strings when playing tremolo? In other words, I assume you dampen with the left hand.
Say that again. I missed two words in it.
Do you dampen with your left hand while you're doing tremolo when you're trying to stop strings from ringing?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there are many tricks that you should do. You know, if, for example, let's say we take the recuerdos again, and you start this. You know, everybody knows that it's quite easy to, when you play, to miss and hit that string. You know, to miss and hit the first string. So, I'm damping the string there. So if I hit it, nothing's going to happen, right? And, you know, towards the end, there's a place that goes... when I'm doing this, I don't leave that open because I got it half covered. Open. And when I'm there, my E is covered, right? So, you know, you learn to put the finger down perfectly and then you put it down badly. You know, in tremolo, it's quite important because it's so easy when you're, you know, especially if it's a fast tremolo and things and you've got things moving onto the second and third string, it's very easy to miss the string and hit the other one. So if it's possible, do some damping, you know. If it's damping basses, those, yeah, sometimes, you know, if you have... that's not very nice because the bass is going to ring a lot. So sometimes the left hand fingering, like it would be, is better than a, you know, use fingerings that are not going to leave the wrong note ringing.
Great. Chris asks, can you elaborate on a problem with a dead note? I assume a weaker note in the tremolo, especially with the A finger. I know in the past you've demonstrated tremolo with A, and accenting the A finger, like, as you said, starting there. Could you elaborate on that?
Sure. I mean, the thing of repeating a note is partly a warm up exercise where you simply, without going too fast, because that's the movement it's going to do. So, and by actually just using the tremolo, it gets rid of boredom. You just go, you know, just to keep that moving. You know, in some ways, it's also a way of finding out at what point do you start to get tense, what point do you start to seize up, and whatever. So you need to make the muscles a little bit tired, right? And then you find out how it's moving. And you know, the A finger, for many people, is a weak finger. So all of the things that we spoke about earlier, which if you missed them, you can listen again. You know, there was that whole bit where I was trying to give as much importance to the A finger as possible. All of that is really relevant. You also, many people don't have a very good sound on the A finger for some reason. Maybe just because of the hand position or whatever, or the, you know, the way the nail grows. So I think it's really important that the tone itself isn't different or isn't too bright. You know, many people have a brighter note. And partly the shape of the hand, you know, this finger, the index, naturally plays with an angle. And this one naturally plays more that way. You know, so your index is this way and your A finger's going this way. So it's often just by this, it's going to sound a little bit brighter. So the shape that you make with the nail, it's going to have to be important. Here's an interesting one, is sometimes you take a single note and then put down two fingers and pluck it with two fingers. It won't sound very perfect, but it should be possible. And these two, right? So that means that those two are going to be able to be played without having to move. And then the three together. So that means that now my hand, this hand position, each finger is going to be able to play. Maybe try some of those things.
Great. Super answer. Jonathan is asking about hearing a difference of attacks and how even he's playing. In slow, he can perceive it. But he gets going faster. He knows it's not right, but it's hard to tell why and how he can hear it to see if it needs improvement. Jonathan, I can tell you on YouTube, you can record yourself and then play it back at half speed or 25% speed. So you'll hear it slow, but it's your fast playing. That's one solution.
Yeah. It's also actually much easier to hear a problem in someone else. You know, it's difficult to perceive yourself just what is happening because there's all the other work, whereas when you hear someone else, it's often quite easy to identify this note is, you know, that this is the one that's hurting and aim at it, you know. But maybe instead of going directly from slow to fast, You need to go through the process until it starts to sound wrong, or starts to sound not as good, and find that point. And that would be a point where you may be able to put your finger on the bit that's not working well. It's usually the coordination. Almost always, it's to do with one note coming too soon, and often that's because one fingernail is slipping across too easily, or one fingernail is catching a little bit. And when you're going slowly, it's easy to control it. When it goes fast, it's much more difficult. That's why that exercise that we talked about before, I mentioned, about emphasizing one note. And then. All right, so I've moved the accent across the fingers. And so in some ways, you get a connection between your brain and the M finger, say, and you really... And then you can learn to either strengthen it or weaken it, you know, which often, you know, I play tremolo many times as an encore at the end of a concert, you know, and your nails are bashed up from playing for things. And sometimes it's quite irregular. So I have to make sure that I'm able to either push one or not pluck one so hard to get it regular, you know, because, you know, it's not easy.
Super. Any specific tips for the tremolo in Capriccio Diabolico?
Not really. No, that was one of the ones that I was going to bring up because I played that piece a lot. But it's just it's a short little bit there. I don't think it's noticeably different from other tremolos. I can't remember it exactly, but it's. I wouldn't say do it different. I would only say do it expressively. You know, don't do it like a kind of mechanical thing. You know, many people play tremolos thinking of the mechanics rather than it's actually a little tune. So think of yourself as if you were a good singer, which I'm not. You would like let the voice grow up and down according to what you like. So for that. You're going to have to get fast and slow and loud and soft, you know. So you're going to have to shape the phrase, really. You know, and phrases are shaped by timing, mostly. You know, the getting loud and soft, yeah, it's important, but your timing is really, really important. So if you've learned to do rubato, which we talked about getting fast and slow, if you've learned to do rubato, you should be able to shape the phrase with your tremolo, hopefully.
Great. Jonathan asked, can you talk specifically about tremolo on the second string? You already talked a little bit about missing and hitting the first string and so forth. But anyway.
Okay. It's important. So now, the way I play, anyway, people have different ideas about how they think. I don't have very much action before the string, you know, so before the string, I'm going to be most about a maximum a centimeter away, right? Right, and so I don't flare my fingers, right? And even more when you're playing on the second string. So I don't know if you can see this, but let's see if you can do it like this. Okay. Right, you can see. Can you see that? Oh, it's this way. Okay, so the finger is never actually up here. I'm aiming for the second string. It never comes to here. It goes. Right? See, so it never goes over the first string, or on the string that's above it or higher in sound. On the E string, if you move a little bit more, if it moves a bit more, it doesn't matter. I mean, I don't try to do this, but right. So that would be my most important suggestion when you're doing that, right? And that way, hopefully, you won't miss the string.
Jonathan asked. You're brief that you describe your process of building up your tremolo to a performance level when you were first beginning to play tremolo.
Yesterday I had a FaceTime with my mum, and we were chatting. I was just telling her, okay, mum, I'm going to be doing this thing. Okay, so you're going to watch it. And when I was a little boy, we lived in Menorca in Spain, and our house had a cave underneath it. It was actually a quarry that's from the Moorish time, you know, like Middle Ages, before the Middle Ages. And the house had a stone floor built over the quarry, and then the house is on top. It's a small quarry, you know, just a big hole in the ground. But it's kind of the size of a church or something. Fantastic acoustics. And my parents were both painters, and that was their art gallery, and they had the paintings stuff there. And I often sat in the gallery, kind of like sitting guard, if you like, and I practiced tremolo. She said, you used to sit down there and go, bim, 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 for hours. So I don't remember it as being hours. It was just, I really wanted to make this work, you know, and I had basically learned recuerdos off an old record of Andrés Segovia. Of course, I played lots of wrong notes and things, but that was the way I'd learned these pieces, by ear, with my father's help. And it just completely mystified me how Segovia could get that up to speed and that way. But slowly it started to go. At that time, I had very little fingernail, and basically I just kind of like, you know, played almost without fingernails. Not typical, you know, because you'd be playing football in the afternoon, and yeah, and so, you know, as a kid, it didn't really look after them. But then when I got a little bit better, you know, I took care of my nails, and I slowly realized that evenness of sound, evenness of rhythm, and evenness of sound is really important.
Great, thank you. Pablo asks from Facebook about what string tension do you prefer to use?
Well, I use normal tension on this. This is my Damon guitar, and it's a D'Addario normal tension. I've used the D'Addario all my life. Well, not all my life, but you know, they've been really good to me and to the guitar world, and they, so I continue. You know, as I've joked with some guitar makers, you know, if it doesn't sound good with the D'Addario normal tension, I'm not going to take one of your guitars. But you know, some guitars do need different tensions. I prefer lower tension for the basses, if possible, because you get more vibrato and things. And if the guitar needs a higher tension on the trebles, okay, put it on. And the Talks guitar, I have a Sabareth on the it just kind of brings out a bit in the middle. That I have another guitar that actually, if you don't put high tension string basses on it, doesn't really sound good. So it depends, really.
Thank you. Henry from Facebook asked about Renaissance music for lute that has tremolo.
Well, there's one. Yes. There's a beautiful piece by Dowland. Wait a sec, where is it? Okay, it's one of the fantasies. It starts like this. So on, and then towards the end, Dowland goes crazy. Goes, it's a way out of tune, but just to get the gist. Here you go, tremolo. So it's one of his fantasies. I can't read very well with this tuning, but while I was looking for pieces that in case we run out of time, that I remember Paul Odette was playing it, and he was not using our tremolo technique. He was doing, because it's the loop technique, he was going. Okay, I don't know if you can see that, sorry. Okay, yeah. Okay, because they play like that. Anyway, there you go.
Thank you. Theophanes from Facebook asks, is there any particularly stretching exercises you do when warming up?
Well, you know, Tom, you and I have spoken about that a couple of times at home because you often do these things. I don't do that very much, and I just never did it, so it's not really something that has been part of my warming up. Maybe it's not a terrible thing to do a little bit, but I would be careful. You know, it's so easy to just go one little bit too far. I mean, Tom, you've been doing it for years, so it's easy, and your fingers are very flexible. But for someone that maybe whose fingers are not very flexible, I wouldn't do it too much. But gentle, yeah, gentle stretching, you know, just to get the feeling of spacing between your fingers. I wouldn't do it too much in the right hand because the movement here is pretty reduced. The left hand may actually need it.
Thank you. Greetings from Greece, from Panos. Other exercises besides standard tremolo that you think would help with tremolo, perhaps any specific studies or specific way of practicing scales?
Well, you could say anything that is related to that this movement would be useful. And sometimes, because this is such a kind of set pattern, to control this set pattern, it's actually nice to break the pattern, you know, and to do tremolos in three notes. I'll just come down so you can see. And then these ones. All of those are going to help so that when you're playing your proper tremolo with your normal action, you have much more control over it because you're not set in a kind of, a pattern that you can't get out of. So I would say use that. Then just, there was one more thing that we could have talked about. The action of tremolo, where you use the three fingers, you can also use it in scales. And Matt Palmer, for example, who was in Tucson, you know, he does these super fast, amazing scales using the three fingers and things. And I sometimes use them. And so I'm using, so you can see it. And so. That's from a piece by Asensio, you know. So sometimes if a scale is just above the speed you can normally do with two fingers, maybe using three once in a while or mixed in with it may actually just give you that little bit extra speed.
Okay, this starts with a comment, which I need to put here because it's really sweet. Hello, thank you so much for this chance to meet with a legend.
Great.
Thank you, David.
You have to be careful because you go from being a future promise to a legend in a blink of an eye, you know. So you want to, you young uh-oh. Guys, be careful. Get going, you know.
Yeah, that's a good question. Is a legend refer to is that a compliment or not, huh? I'm just joking. Do you recommend practicing tremolo with rest strokes?
I've never done it. I mean, I've tried to do it because as a student, I was with Hector Quine, and Quine had learned from Bream, and they did a lot of this and mixing in rest stroke and things. I think more for arpeggio, to be able to do a rest stroke on the A finger, I think is a really important way. You know, for tarraga pieces, again, I'll move it down so you can see my so. So that's just one note. But as a student, they asked us to play everything, so these kind of patterns, like, you know, and so I can do it. And so if you want, yeah, you can do it, but it's a little bit weird. It feels like, you know, it doesn't feel fluid.
One thing I can say related to that, having a lot of experience with David and his technique and his philosophy, he can make really the same sound. And it's part of the beauty of his tremolo is because his free stroke already sounds like a rest stroke. So it does. He really has always emphasized his free stroke to sound like a rest stroke. So just taking off on your question, Ari,
yeah. I would just say, Tom, that, you know, if you have a fantastic rest stroke and a really bad free stroke, you know, or a weak sound in your free stroke, your general playing is going to sound weak because there are so many notes that you simply can't play rest stroke because of arpeggios, chords. Every time you've got two notes, so thirds, they're not going to sound good. So the free stroke is really, really important. And then the rest stroke, you're going to include it as a kind of luxury. I use a lot of rest stroke, you know, and depending on the guitar I'm playing, some guitars really sound great when you add, like, the Damon. It really needs quite a lot of rest stroke. But if your free stroke is weak, it's going to hurt your playing, you know. So a long time ago, I started to work a lot on my free stroke because I felt that my free stroke was much weaker than my rest stroke. And there was a time, you know, I'll say that in the 60s or whatever, that many players, even some of the very good players, the playing was often kind of lumpy because the rest strokes popped out so much more than some of the other notes, which, yeah, it could be fine if you want to do that on purpose to make something full of accents or things, that's fine. But you should be making the accents because you want it, not because your hand wants it.
All right. There's two more questions here. One is from Santi. He would like to know about practicing in increments, 60%, 70%, 80%, up to goal speed, or do you recommend just start at 90% and go for it after that?
No. Always do something slow because you'll discover more things when you do things slow. The only problem with it is that sometimes we move different when we go slow than when we go fast. You know, we actually use different muscles, and so you need to go through the process, but you need to do sometimes things at full speed. You know, maybe with tremolo you could, but I'm thinking of, you know, say you want to get your little scales fast, you know, and you want to improve your speed there. Well, sometimes if you take it in little bits and make sure that three notes are going to work, four notes. Right, now, so if you simply did them fast, sorry, if you simply did them slow, there's no problem. So sometimes you find that to do a long scale fast is much more difficult than to do just four notes fast. But start with four, and then do five, and then do six. You know, don't just go straight for the whole thing. And with tremolo, that's why at the beginning we spoke a little bit about, right at the very beginning, I just included it a little bit of, make sure that that's okay. Can we do that? Is it easy to go fast between M and I? And then A and M. And if one of those is not easy, then your tremolo is going to be bad. So yeah, sometimes you can do fast things, but in really small bits. Don't just suddenly go, because you just fling it all out the window. And one of the things, I mean, you've heard me say this quite often, Tom, but every time you do something badly, you actually hurt yourself. You know, you've done something that your body, you're kind of imprinting something that's a mess. You know, and every time you do something really well, you're imprinting a good movement. And also, it's important when you're practicing to raise your level of expectation, what you really expect from yourself. Now, if you're willing to sit there and play a really crappy clattery tremolo, then you just, your ears just close up and you just accept it. It's no good. You know, you have to compare yourself with the best and say, I want my tremolo to get close to that. So raise your expectations and aim for that, and don't accept bad playing. If you do accept bad playing, or you accept dirty playing just because you want to go fast, then you know, it's not, it's, you're just hurting yourself. You know, it's a bit like, you don't have to be the fastest tremolo player in the world. You just have to be the smoothest and the most expressive. You know, if there was somebody that once said, if talking fast was important, Danny Kaye would have been the best actor in the world because he could talk faster than anyone else. No, it doesn't matter. I mean, he was good at that and being very funny or whatever. But some other people are super bright, like the guy that, the, what's he called, Bernstein, the one from the Watergate, you know, who talks very, very slowly, but really clearly. So you always understand. And his brain is completely clean and he knows exactly what it's going to say and he just doesn't rush it. Well, maybe we should play like that sometimes.
That's interesting. This morning I was watching a video of Barack Obama and his children said, you're too recognizable and you talk really slow and your voice is low. So they changed his name and made him talk fast with a high-pitched voice.
Really?
Yeah. There's two more questions and then we'll wrap this up. Janos from Facebook asked about the tremolo and Rodrigo's junto al generalife. Is that any different?
No, I don't think it, I mean, I don't think it's different. You know, it's used. I don't think it needs to go at the massive speed that I want anyway in the invocation and dance. You know, it's in the invocation and dance, it's a kind of central part of the piece. I think it's much more more important. But in some other pieces, like in the Generalife or in the Capriccio Diabolico, for example, it's a passing part. You know, it's not the most important part. So I don't feel...
David, could I ask something? It's just in that piece, I think what they're referencing is that within the tremolo, there's some sections where instead of getting a bass note and four notes, the bass note becomes part of the tremolo as well.
Yeah.
So you have, you know, three notes of tremolo plus then one bass note that's the tremolo and then three more notes of tremolo. I think that's why they were asking whether you would use the thumb for that extra note or whether
I'd use the thumb. It's not the piece that I've played, you know, so, but definitely the technique of being able to play on the top note. So yeah, come on. And then you decide if you want to accent it or not. It's a little bit, my fingers are going to sleep, but I would probably use the thumb on it. You know, if it would, you can do the pattern that just continues. But you wouldn't get enough notes.
Oh, okay. I want to thank people for the questions. They're really good questions. Last one is from Dean from Facebook. He's asking about the index in that it's shorter. Do you reach out to grab the string,
yes,
or do you change your hand position to make everything kind of the same length, or both?
If I change my hand to make the same length, my sound suffers. So if I wanted the extra round sound, then it has to play a bit straighter than the other ones. That's why that thing of playing the three notes, that's if I want that super warm sound, right? But if you go, but then the sound is a bit clicky. It's more incisive. So if I wanted a more bright sound, some people do play more, which kind of evens up that. I don't do that. I just stretch that out a little bit. But, you know, many of these things depend so much on what shape your nail is. And I don't mean what shape you make it. It's what shape your body makes, you know, and some nails are flatter, some nails are squint, you know, so many minute little differences, and we all have to adjust a little bit according to what we've got, you know, and basically aim at getting what we spoke about right at the beginning, the evenness of sound. And if you need to stretch out a little bit, do so, you know, it's no problem.
All right, well, listen, I want to say, you know, I knew that asking David to illuminate his technical ideas, you know, back in the day, I said, how in the heck are you getting that sound? He goes, well, let me, in the enthusiasm, he shares his ideas. He said, well, try this. I mean, it's like, great, you can get like a sound of a restroom on every note in the chord, and various simple things like he would wear a t-shirt that someone gave him and says, I use a dot, which in the day was like, it was like a sin that you would put a dot on the seventh fret. Now it's pretty common. So there it is. There's David's dot. So
it's
David,
like, David,
it's a movable dot. David, you're the best. We are very fortunate to have you as a guide, as a friend. Happy Thanksgiving to you and your family. Happy Thanksgiving to your mother, who, thank God, she bore you into this world and shares your genius with all of us. Thanks, everybody, for coming today. Once again.
Bye-bye, everybody. That was
fantastic. Thank you, David. Thank you so much. That was great.
Thanks, Michelle. Thanks, Anna. Thanks, Tom. Thanks, Edwin. Thanks, everybody.
Take care, everyone.